Hey everyone, WaddlerD. We're back for a new installment of Doom the Golden Souls 2 for any possible system that's a computer. And we're going to be talking about a few things. One thing, I need to apologize to Bat Andy and his team and the viewers for basically kind of being kind of negative about this thing. And after beating this game, I'll just tell you this. This is one of the best things I played all year. Especially in a first-person shooter format, because honestly, there's not a lot of first-person shooters those days that have heart and soul like this one was screaming out to me as I progressed through the game. More to the point, it gets better. It gets much better, but we got to get through the first two worlds, because that's where most of the problems lie. But once you get past that, you start seeing a trend upward and how Bat and his team improve and get into it themselves, and then they start pushing you towards that, and it's just fantastic what you see. So let me be more positive about this and critique the levels as we go on at the end of them. So let's talk about the Oriental Garden. And it's a great place to start off with the positives, because just take a look at this level and tell me. They're going to be kicking ass with how these levels are looking. And the thing that makes me sad about it is the music reminds me of a character that's been very neglected lately. Konami, where the fuck is Goemon? Like, seriously, I'm sorry. Where the heck is your star pupil that you've been working on for so many freaking years, and then you're like, oh, that's fine. We'll be just pushing out Castlevania and freaking Contra like no tomorrow, which are indeed two good ones, but damn. Also, these doors are not actually doors, and this floor kicks ass. I just find it funny that you can see reflection until you do this. It's kind of crazy. But this is basically a door-busting section. A lot of things that you're going to run into are in close quarters and usually dead because you have the shotgun and they don't. But that doesn't mean that it's a good idea to miss and have them attack you, so be wary of that if your shotgun is out of ammo and you are facing an enemy that's still alive. Also, what the hell is this about? That's a fine piece of demon steel. I don't understand the reference, but if you do, share in the comments, because that would be nice. This section is kind of an interesting choke point, because you got enemies flanking you on the left and right, and you also have this Hell Knight in front of you, and the Imp Peanut Gallery behind all of that. My focus here is usually the Hell Knight, because he's going to be doing the most damage. And these guys are probably not going to be hitting you as much, because too much stuff in the way, and the Imp Peanut Gallery doesn't really participate. They just watch and see, oh shit, Doomguy's kicking all our asses. Then you want to head down here, because guess what's down here? It's pretty simple. It's a freaking big-ass coin. Collect it. And then we'll surface back up here, say hello to the skeet shooting gallery here, because the shotgun does a pretty decent job at like this kind of range. It's kind of incredible how it just drops these guys with... Oh, no. Yeah, we gotta talk about the freaking blue sniffets. The blue sniffets have 3 pellet bursts. Very dangerous, considering that if you're up close, they can cause some damage, and if they're far away, they can snipe you. So you really want to take care of them whenever you see them on the screen, because they are a menace in all ranges. You know, I find it funny that somebody decides to leave their pocket change on top of this Tory. It's kind of incredible at times. And then you reach this part, and you're like, oh crap, can we skip it? Can we get up here? No, we have to go in the water. Which, I mean, water's not a bad thing in this game, but it's certainly a lot of like, oh shit, I wish I was running around. But water does provide an interesting perspective where you, instead of being on dry land moving horizontally with jumping, you are basically able to move freely however you please. But that also means that the enemies are able to hit you however they please. But the funny part about these water sections is that they're really damn noisy, because the enemies just make a ton of ambience. And this is a funny part with these tentacles here. They will not attack you until you enter the room. So if you're feeling low on health, you can snipe them from that doorway or that entryway, and you basically won't have to worry about what I was dealing with there. Though, if you're thinking a shotgun's always a good choice, the rifle does a fantastic job against the tentacles because it just stuns them so much that they won't be able to attack. So, if you're feeling like, you know what, I'm tired of getting attacked by these damn things, you can bust out your rifle, or you could be a dumbass like me and use a shotgun because I just love how it works so much. But once you get past all of that, switch, backtracking, it's not too bad of a backtrack. I mean, it's better than jumping through hoops, but here, you get greeted with... Oh, Caco Demon, what the hell? You are being incredibly lazy right now. Usually a Caco Demon is like waiting at the pool, but here he's like on the distance, so I guess rifling him is the only answer here. So once you're done dealing with the garden pests, we gotta save our game, because we got some jumping to deal with, and you do not want to start from the beginning of the level. I mean, if you're a brave lad, you can definitely do the checkpoint system, but I prefer not wasting my precious time these days. So let's talk about this sniffet trying to make my life miserable, but more importantly, the dancing mad imps. I just love how these guys are spazzing out on these platforms and being in the way, but a shotgun ruins about the whole thing, so I'm sorry guys. I know the song kicks ass, but we gotta progress. So once you hit the switch, you wanna jump back, collect some goodies along the way, and say hello to that platform now rised up and ready to apply some freaking bullets upon this evil plant's face. Man, I feel bad for these guys. They just cannot touch you if you're like too far away. Once you get to this point, you got more platforming to do, but thankfully the checkpoint's positioned right before all of it. This section's kind of tricky, because you have a bunch of freaking blue sniffets and red sniffets trying to snipe you, and red plants that will punish you if you're too jumpy around them, because if there's one thing I forgot to tell you, there's a coin in here. And if that sniffet will do a fun job sniping you at times and possibly killing you because it will knock you in the abyss. But you saw that red plant and how in the air its accuracy just got a lot better and the fireball whizzed past my ear. That's how dangerous those guys can be if you're too jumpy around them. So stick to the ground when you're running around the evil plants because they will mess your shit up. So you probably might know what's in here. Sup, demons, how you doing? Yeah, you definitely want to watch the corners here, because the enemies here are trying to ambush you. The funny thing is you could possibly have the imps help you out here by being unfriendly with the Hell Knight, but unfortunately they just decide to run away and not get hit by anything. No crossfire whatsoever, guys. You guys suck. But this evil plant does not suck. He's actually in a pretty good spot until you realize you got distance on your side. But you do want to be careful with these jumps here because you don't want to do all this over again. Then you have the double Hell Knight squad here. This is the first time they're starting to throw them in duos. But the funny thing is that they're not doing it. They're not like throwing too much at you yet. But after you get past all these Tories, you have to say hello to not just this evil plant, but 60 more enemies in this cramped-ass hedge maze. I'm not gonna lie, this is not my favorite part of the level, but we gotta be positive here. And the way to do that is to talk about the fist real quick. Thank you, Falcon. I appreciate that. So yeah, the fists have an uppercut. I never bothered to mention that because, you know, you're never supposed to use your fist in Doom unless your berserk is all hell. But the uppercut does kind of kick ass, both in style and how effective it is. Well, that was not an effective use of the shotgun, but, I mean, the shotgun does have its oh god, speaking of shotgun, hello spread. Yeah, green sniffets we'll talk about a little bit more later. They are very dangerous, as you just saw. Oh, crap. So one thing I have to discuss here. Like, Bat and Dean, your team, what were you thinking with this placement of this red plant? Just curious, because this red plant is basically cut off from life itself. literally doomed to shoot fireballs at a wall. Not to say that all red plants are placed poorly here, but that's one of the worst I've seen. I love how the imps and killer plants are talking about how similar they are to one another until the imps start dying first, then you're like, oh, that's the difference. You know, I guess this is going to be the running gag of the episode.
Yeah! Punch! 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 Come on! Show me your moves! Punch! Punch! Yeah! Falcon! Punch! Yes!
If you don't get the reference, what other game are you going to see a grown man punch a plant to death? Smash Brothers. Also, this is the part where you do not want to be, like, thinking, ooh, bunny, because you're going to run into a ambush, trap kind of situation where you have a Hell Knight on your right and a evil plant on your left. The worst kind of thing to get sandwiched with in between, because they're going to probably kill you. So, I don't know how the hell I got through that, but that's what happens if you're like, money's good! No, greed's bad. Oh shit, speaking of bad. The green sniffed. Definitely not the sign of money, because this thing can kill you real damn quick up close. So, keep your distance. They are probably the most annoying sniffed you're going to run into, but it's not as annoying as this whole section here, where you just basically run through this maze, kill everything you see, and yeah, there's more sniffeds. What a shock. Even the Hell Knight is like, okay, reduced to fast forward mode, because this is the half, other half of this level. Oh, right, another plant. Damn it, you asshole. Yeah, the evil plants definitely do not get a good run here, but thankfully, this is probably the worst level I've seen them in. Like, you'll start to see them be more effective and more dangerous, but this level... Oh, speaking of which, there it is. Yeah, they can be very well placed, it's just that the ones that are crammed in the most ridiculous of spots... Not a fan. Not a fan of it all, but... I'm trying not to be critiquing too much, but... come on, guys. Oh. Yeah, cannot forget about the snippets here. They are very dangerous. It looks like my pride got to me. I got frickin' my arm nearly bitten off, but thankfully we have a heart that I frickin' needed. Yeah, I love how the game actually keeps tabs of how much health you have and how much you need hearts. But we are nearing the done of this hedge maze. If you're wondering how I feel about it, it's not positive. This is probably the worst section of this level. But it's not to say that it's a bad section, it's just, oh, especially when we have these moments where you have evil plants kind of kicking your ass for being a little too ingrained in the cycle. But we're nearing the end of it. Oh, jeez, man. You know, I've been making fun of these evil plants, but they are finding ways to do the most damage to me in this damn evil maze. Before we go back too far, you want to make sure to hit this switch, because it controls a certain gate that we kind of passed on the way here. Once you've hit these last couple of switches, you are officially done with this hedge maze. But there are a few more enemies to run into, like this guy. I mean, whenever you play Doom 64, a Hell Knight is sure to follow. But I think I haven't covered one last thing. There is a map that you can use to... basically look at the whole maze right here and there. But we gotta do a thing first. Almost forgot about this big ass coin. With every nook and cranny explored, I think it would be a great time to do that thing that I was mentioning earlier in this video. The review. This pro section is going to be an easy one. The atmosphere and presentation are some of the best parts about this level. The combat orientation of the level gives a good change of pace from the instant death that I've been dealing with. And more importantly, the music choice is definitely on point. It makes me miss Goemon, but you have Bakeru to help you get through that wait. Curious players will also be rewarded with some little extra goodies, and the indoor sections were pretty damn fun. I want to talk about my issues with the backtracking up to this point. it's all right to have backtracking in your game. It's just not all right when you do nothing with it. For example, Doom has monster claws. It's ways to resolve these kind of issues where you're going through areas that have already been cleared out. Instead, we had a situation where we had a hedge mage where I was just running back through areas after killing everything and facing some weird enemy placement from time to time that made me question what they were thinking here. But despite the negativity, I still enjoyed this level a fair bit, and I would consider it decent, because it's the best looking level in World 1 easily. The combat focus is a nice change of pace, like I said before, but the only problem is that you get thrown into this hedge maze that just seems like it was added at the end, when they could have had an indoor section with doors, cramped locations. It was just a missed opportunity that they could have explored a lot more. Kind of a shame. But before we leave this level, I am very curious about what this says. If anyone can translate this and share in the comments, it would be great to understand what they're trying to tell me at the end of this pretty decent level. I just wish we didn't have the hedge mage. Like, don't bait and switch in your level, please. And of course, we gotta say hello to Crash and her wonderful stock of supplies. And the important thing I have to say is we'll be getting that soon. We'll talk more about shop matters later on, because we're gonna introduce ourselves to a different kind of level. It's a ghost house. Why am I hyping these places up? It's simple. They have a much different design than most levels you experience in this game, and there's always one in each world. And Bat Andy does one thing incredibly well, and that's creating spooky environments and immersing you in them. This level starts off pretty tame and easy. Couple snippets, some new guy running up there, and interactive stuff. You see these chests and these bases? Oh god, I broke one. Yeah, if you are very curious, you will find that breaking certain ones gives you money. Like, these ones with the yellow bands have money, and these chests, while you can't shoot them open, you can use them to get the coins inside of them, which is great. I like that. I really enjoy when the game adds some elements. Fine, we'll introduce you. This is a mummy. He's already dead. But this thing, a golden spider? This is the thing you really want. It has a skull jewel. And we'll learn more about these doors later when we have the keys, but skull jewels are what you want to find when you're in a ghost house. You're going to see them contained within the body of a golden spider, and they're usually well hidden throughout the levels. But, oh no, you did not make these things. Oh shit. So, these are ghost souls. They work much differently than your usual lost souls, because they have intangibility until you look away and shoot them. Yeah, they become tangible for a short amount of time, and that's the time where you have to kill them. But if you don't look at them long enough, they will charge at you and do damage. But that is a ghost soul. One of the more interesting but annoying enemies that you're going to experience in this total conversion. I'm sorry, mummy. I'm sorry that you are one of the most useless enemies in the game. Like, the only time there will ever be threatening is an enclosed space with a shotgun where you miss twice and have to reload. So the reoccurring theme of Ghost House. Ghosts, gold spiders, dumbass mummies. That's pretty much all you need to know when it comes to Ghost House. Speaking of mummies, hold on a moment.
Show me your moves! Punch! 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 Yeah! Falco punch!
Bastard got me at the end. So, this is probably one of the easiest ghost house. Damn it. One of the easiest ghost house that you can go through, because the enemy presence is not very threatening. It's nice and bright thanks to all the glittering gold, and the hell is this? This isn't the standard fare Doom weapon. What is this thing? It's a green little toy gun. So what are your feelings on charged weapons? Because this is exactly what it does. It charges, it shoots. You can shoot your pew-pews, or you can shoot a big old blast of energy. the thing that makes it interesting is that you have unlimited ammo. You will actually even fire if it has zero, and it will recharge its ammunition by two every time you just let it sit. So it's pretty useful in that it doesn't use up your resources, and it can give. Very important detail. Please do not forget that part, because there will be an enemy that you will want to use this on. Alright, I think I got my mileage from these fists at this point, but the energy blaster is a weapon that's just got some interesting qualities to it, but none of them are just fantastic. They don't really stand out in a lot of ways, and damn it, mummy, stop trying to be in this damn video. I understand that you're an enemy, but we have to talk about something more threatening. The Baron of Hell, one of the most iconic Doom enemies you can think of. The big boy that you thought in Doom 1 and wish you had a rocket launcher or a super shotgun at the time. And he's dead after 10 of these shots. Gotta say, Energy Blaster does have its place, but it's just a weird spot. It's like a weapon that we're going to get more familiar with as time goes on. Unfortunately, that time is running short, because we have another level coming up that's going to require a lot more discussion when it happens. So I hope you all enjoyed this video. Next time we will talk about Calcent Castle, one of the best named levels with a boss at the end, the final exam of World 1. Thanks for watching, have a great day, and adios.